Please join me in welcoming Dr. McCabe.
Well, good morning, everyone, and welcome. Thank you much for being here. And boy, what an inspiring, energetic first talk. I'm not going to have you stand up and do all kinds of calisthenics and that, but you're certainly more than welcome to stand during all this. So, you know, Laura talked a lot about how there's this movement toward this whole idea of well-being. And again, it's a more holistic look at our whole lives. And as Laura mentioned, you know, whether it's five aspects of well-being, which the Gallup people have really pushed, or whether it's six aspects of well-being, we're understanding, you know, the whole person comes to work, and you certainly may be very engaged in physical well-being, but we don't think about financial, we don't think about our community, our spiritual. So, you know, the workplace and the world is becoming more and more complicated all the time, and there's this whole idea of resiliency, and how do we make ourselves more resilient? You know, as humans, we are hardwired to be resilient. Some of us are certainly more resilient than others, but we can actually train ourselves to be more resilient. So our topic today is enhancing your resiliency, training your brain for happiness. And you may say, well, wow, do you really have to train your brain for happiness? Well, as we go through and explain about how our brains are wired, you'll learn more that it's not our brain's main job is not to make us happy, and we actually can work at it, and we can actually train ourselves to be happier. So to tee this topic off, I'm just going to show you a short video about this whole topic of happiness and what are the different aspects of happiness.
In the last 6 months, more than 1,000 books have been published about it. Universities around the world are teaching on it. For 30 years, scientists have been studying it. Governments are appointing cabinet positions to oversee it. The United Nations named an official day after it. Google Analytics prove people are searching for it. In fact, it's one of humanity's oldest pursuits. Happiness. We are wealthier, more educated, and live longer than any previous generation. And as a nation, the U.S. is one of the wealthiest, most powerful, and technologically advanced. And in the most recent World Happiness Report, the United States ranked 17th. And during the Great Depression, when there was little to be happy about, we were actually 18% less depressed than we are now. We have been taught that hard work equals success, which equals happiness, right? Wrong. Research proves happiness is actually a precursor to success, not the other way around. Did you know? Neuroscience proves that we are hardwired to perform at our best when we are happy. Studies show that happy, positive, optimistic people earn higher incomes, set and achieve more aggressive goals, experience less stress, remain calm in high-pressure situations, are more energetic, recover from illness faster, and live longer. Happiness is serious business. When we engage in positive, real-life relationships, our bodies release chemicals that actually help reduce anxiety and increase concentration and focus. How you feel and your attitude toward life all stem from your thoughts, actions, and where you focus your time and energy. Yet we are constantly surrounded by negativity. If we want things to change, we have to create the change. And we start by choosing positivity and happiness. Just imagine the possibilities if there were more happy and positive people in this world. A world with more peace, optimism, and compassion is possible. Like a pebble thrown into a pond, it only takes one to create the ripple of happiness. Happiness is so contagious and infectious that one positive person can spread happiness to more than 1,000 people. That means all it takes to create change on a local, regional, state, country, global scale is one person. And research shows that just by spreading happiness, you actually become happier. You can choose happiness and choose to share it. You can be the catalyst to spread it directly and indirectly. Are you that one? It starts with you, yet it's bigger than you. Happiness is bold. It is courageous, audacious, and challenging. You have the power to choose happiness and to spread it. Join the movement. Share the movement. Be the one who makes the difference. And live happy.
So there's a lot of data in there, but I think two of the things that struck me is that I've seen this video over and over, that the most powerful, wealthiest nation in the world is 17th on the world happiness scale, right behind Panama and Mexico. And number two, we're more depressed as a nation now than we were during the Great Depression. Well, that's not a very positive thing in life, and we must got to do something different. We'll go through some of the other data. But you know, if you go out and you look at Webster and you look at this definition of happiness, this is what you'll get. Good fortune or prosperity, and people will say, well, I don't need a definition of happiness. I know it when I feel it. But if you look at it, and there's a huge amount of data out there now about gratitude and happiness, if you look at the happiness literature, you're going to get a different definition of what happiness is. And almost universally, it's this definition: a deep and sustained fulfillment from living a good, virtuous, and meaningful life. So it's not just, it's not seeking sensory pleasure, and it's not material goods for oneself. It's a deeper, more holistic look at our lives. So they went through and they talked about a number of the health benefits of being happy. You know, but you know, again, we go through things. When you're happier, your genes are happier. Hardening of your arteries and arteriosclerosis is an inflammatory process. So if we can reduce inflammation, that's a positive thing for our overall health and well-being. Your tissues are happier, your cells are happier, and you're younger than your physiologic, than your chronologic age. Your immune system is happy. Happier people at work miss less time. They get less respiratory infections during the winter months. Your heart is happy. You have less risk for heart disease. You know, we list all these risk factors for heart trouble, you know, high blood pressure and diabetes and smoking. We don't list the anger disease. If you've got the anger disease, you want to get rid of it, because that's a higher risk for heart problems than the combination of smoking and diabetes. You're more physically active. It's obviously positive for your overall health. If you've got chronic pain, that's less. They mentioned in the video about spreading it to 1,000 people. It's interesting that Laura talked about in wellness and physical activity that as you practice it, you get other people and you spread it to other people. You're more creative. As I've given this talk to our global product supply people and our marketing people, all the managers, they always like this one. You're more productive. Happier people are more productive. You live longer. But I think you can name all of those things and you can list all those, but I think the last one in my mind is the most important. The opposite of happy just isn't unhappy. It's angry, sick, and distressed, and that's just not a way you want to go through your life. So, the question was, do you train yourself to be happy? And the reason we have to actually work at it is our brains were not hardwired to keep us happy. Our brain's main job was to keep us alive and keep us safe. That's what primitive man had to decide within about 20 seconds, whether the person walking toward him was going to club him over the head, kill him, and take all his belongings. We still are hardwired subconsciously that way of safety and survival. And this predisposition for safety and survival predisposes us to unhappiness. So if you look out, and research has shown that certainly some of happiness is hardwired, or it's ingrained. The people with the glasses half full. So research would tell you that 40% of your happiness is genetics. 10% are circumstances, but a full 50% of how happy you are is due to conscious choices that we make. So, well, why is it that our brain is predisposed to be less happy? Well, we have neural predispositions to the following three things. You mind wander. And you will mind wander at least 50% of your day. You started mind wandering when you woke up this morning. The estimates now are that we might wander between 50 and 80% of our day. My goal for the next 20 minutes here is to keep you more like 50%, not 80%. Number two, you have a negativity bias, and just recognize this. This is just background on why we actually have to train ourselves. So as you make decisions today or throughout your life, whether it's a personal decision, whether it's a financial decision, whether it's a business decision, you are going to stack the negative reasons to make that decision over the positive at about a 6-to-1 ratio. So we're predisposed to negativity. And then there's this third concept of hedonic adaptation. And that's this notion that after events happen in our lives, whether they're very positive events or negative events, that within a short period of time, we will regress to our prior set point of happiness. Now, this is great when bad things happen to us, like the loss of a spouse or a loved one, but it's not so good when positive things happen. And an example of this is they've done surveys, and they've looked at lottery winners, and they've surveyed them a year after they've won over $1 million. And they asked them, are you happier now after winning the $1 million than you were before? And almost 80% will say they're no happier now than they were before the winning the $1 million. And that's this because of this hedonic adaptation. So these are neural predispositions that we have. We can overcome them, and we can make ourselves happier, but we have to work at it. So let's talk a little bit about how our brains are wired and how our mind actually works. So your brain is actually 90 billion nerve cells, and it's wired into networks. Because of these networks, our brain is a conflicted organ and it's a busy organ. So conflicted, and what do I mean by that, is that if we look at our brains and we think about it, there's actually two big parts to it. The colored part in the middle is the limbic system, and that's our primitive brain. That's the only brain that prehistoric man had. And that's the part of our brain that houses our emotions. It's where we have our short-term decision-making and our more instant gratification. And then as we evolved as a species, we added the cortex, and that's our higher thinking brain, or the new brain. That's our long-term decision making. That's more of our compassionate part of our brain. So when we say your brain is conflicted, you essentially are walking around with two consultants in your brain that are telling you different things. And if you've ever brought in a consultant at your work and asked them, you'll get two different opinions. So right now, as you're going through your day, you have the limbic system telling you to think about short-term decision and instant gratification, and then you have your cortex that's telling you, no, think longer, be more compassionate. So you've got, our brains are conflicted. It's a very busy organ, and even at rest, there's actually constant activity, and this constant activity is actually these networks forming and dissolving. It looks chaotic, but it is actually quite structured. And it is the forming and dissolving of these networks that leads to our two modes of how our brain works. Our focus mode, which the brain really likes to do, and then our default, our mind wandering. And the problem is, with our modern world, it is predisposing us to mind wander more and more. So I'm just going to show you a video. This is a nuclear scan of these networks forming and dissolving. And this is our brain. This is even at rest. So right now, we think there's about 35 networks. You're hopefully engaging in five of them. You're engaging your visual networks. You're actually looking at this. You're engaging your auditory networks. So you're actually listening. You're engaging your postural networks. So you're either sitting or standing. You're disengaging your dialogue network, so you're not mind wandering 80% of the time, and you're engaging your focus network, so you're actually listening somewhat to what we have to say. So our brain loves to be focused. It loves, but it has to find our external world interesting. And when it finds it boring or uninteresting, it goes into the default mode. And the problem with being mind wandering is when we're mind wandering and we're in this unfocused mode, we think negative thoughts. And so if we're spending 80% of our time mind wandering, we're going to be brooding about things that have happened to us that aren't so good. So we want to spend less and less time mind wandering. So people say, well, I don't mind wander. Well, if any of these things have happened to you, it isn't because you're showing early signs of dementia. It's because you're mind wandering. And Laura mentioned the person who was mind wandering, who walked into the elevator shaft. You know, I tell people, they say, well, I can't remember where I put my keys. And I say, well, that's all right. That's mind wandering. If you don't remember what to do with them when you find them, then you should seek help because there is something serious going on. So, and then our mind, so that's how our brain is wired. And then how does our mind actually work? Well, the natural modus is that it thinks threat first, it's also very restless, and it's irrational. So we pay attention to these things in this order. We pay attention to threat first, novelty second, and pleasure last. We mentioned earlier that threat superiority was necessary for survival. We're still hardwired that way. However, most of the threats for the people in this room, now there's parts of the world where physical threat is still a big issue, but for most of us, our threats are in our mind, and those are hurts, regrets, sorrows, and fears. And those are negative thoughts. Our mind is also restless. It's driven by this desire to keep us safe, and that's an impossible task. We have a bottomless pit of desires, and we can see what we can, you know, what the world offers and what we can obtain. The pace of today's life, and I mentioned this earlier, it's estimated that at the current time that all of us have probably 150 undone tasks. And when you get up, and you can do this later in the day, when you can just list, well, how many emails did you answer, how many Twitters, how many texts did you get, how many, you know, did you start thinking about what you're going to make for dinner tonight, you're going to pick up the kids. The more undone tasks you have, the more you're going to mind wander because you're just constantly thinking about that. And then we have this idea of choice fatigue. We have a lot of choices in today's world, and our mind confuses the amount of choice with it must be important. And then it's not an all or nothing, but we're more predisposed to be more short-sighted than long-term thinking. We tend to have a more of a lack of self-control than full control. We're guided by rigid biases. And if you don't think we're guided by rigid biases, if you watched any of the presidential debates last fall, it's almost all rigid biases and not necessarily true facts. We tend to jump to premature conclusions, and then we get hijacked by our impulses, infatuations, and fears. So this is just background on why we tend to be predisposed to unhappiness. And so you may say, well, if this is the way we're hardwired, can we really overcome that? And the answer to that is yes. And Laura touched on this idea of neuroplasticity. You know, we used to think our brains were hardwired and were fixed by the time we reached, you know, late teenage years. We now recognize that our brains are constantly rewiring. And so you are constantly rewiring. That's called neuroplasticity. And we'll just show you a quick video about that explains neuroplasticity.
Not so long ago, many scientists believed that the brain did not change after childhood, that it was hardwired and fixed by the time we became adults. But recent advances in only the last decade now tell us that this is simply not true. The brain can and does change throughout our lives. It is adaptable, like plastic. Hence, neuroscientists call this neuroplasticity. How does neuroplasticity work? If you think of your brain as a dynamic, connected power grid, there are billions of pathways or roads lighting up every time you think, feel, or do something. Some of these roads are well travelled. These are our habits, our established ways of thinking, feeling, and doing. Every time we think in a certain way, practice a particular task, or feel a specific emotion, we strengthen this road. It becomes easier for our brains to travel this pathway. Say we think about something differently, learn a new task, or choose a different emotion. We start carving out a new road. If we keep traveling that road, our brains begin to use this pathway more, and this new way of thinking, feeling, or doing becomes second nature. The old pathway gets used less and less and weakens. This process of rewiring your brain by forming new connections and weakening old ones is neuroplasticity in action. The good news is that we all have the ability to learn and change by rewiring our brains. If you have ever changed a bad habit or thought about something differently, you have carved a new pathway in your brain and experienced neuroplasticity firsthand. With repeated and directed attention towards your desired change, you can rewire your brain.
So I gave this talk to the HR group at our company about 2.5 years ago, and I mentioned that, and my boss was there, and sort of brought up this idea of neuroplasticity, and I said, you know, my problem with your boss being here and listening to this is, if she tells me that I have to learn this new task or this new way of doing something, and I say I can't learn it, she'll just say, no, you have neuroplasticity. So there was a downside to that. So that's how we're wired. So how do we go about training our brain for happiness? So we're going to talk about two things. Training our attention so that we're less prone to mind wander. And then talking about reframing life's challenges using higher principles. How do we lower the threshold that these higher principles that we live by just become more second nature to us? So, training our attention, waking up with gratitude, paying attention to the beauty in the world around us, finding novelty in loved ones, and then kind attention is how we interact with strangers that we meet each day. And instead of using judgmental attention, we start to practice kind attention. So, waking up with gratitude. So, you know, as I mentioned earlier, the minute you woke up, you started mind wandering. You started thinking about all the things that you have to do that day. So instead of doing that, before you get out of bed, wake up and picture in your mind 5 people or pets that are either in your life now or were in your life, and just picture them in a happy, beautiful setting. And just say a silent thank you that they have been in your life or are still in your life today. So I do this every morning. And if you've gotten out of bed and you haven't done it, go back to bed and start over. I gave this to one group, and one person raised their hand and said, well, I'm going to be late for work. And I said, well, this isn't going to take you 45 minutes. This is a 5-minute exercise. Or I had one employee who posted it on the mirror. So if she's forgotten to do it before she's gotten up, as she's brushing her teeth, and she goes, oh, that's right, I gotta think about and be grateful for these people in my lives. And then you can do this throughout the day. When you're sitting in traffic, instead of getting angry that the traffic's moving slow, you can stop and you can be grateful. And you're just seeing this huge explosion in all the positive aspects of gratefulness and how it's probably one of the most important things we can do. Pay attention to the beauty in the world around us. Our world buzzes by and we don't notice the beauty in the world around us. And when we do this, it trains us to just have a deeper attention and to be less mind-wandering. So I took this picture a couple of years ago, and it's just some tiger lilies, and this was up north. And most people say, well, that's a nice picture of tiger lilies, but we can delve deeper into it. Did you notice the different, you know, how many flowers were there? Did you notice how many petals were on each flower? Did you notice the different shades of orange? Did you notice the little stapes in the middle with the little crimson tips? Did you notice the leaves down below in the flowers? Are the clouds being reflected in the window? We just don't pay attention in our world around us, and this can be at any time of the year. I gave this talk two years ago to our global insights group, and this was about 150 people. Racine is about 30 minutes south of Milwaukee, and they were having the meeting up in Milwaukee, and it was a beautiful October day. Sun was shining, leaves were at peak color change. So the meeting was in the afternoon, so everybody had to drive up there, and I asked people who were at the meeting, I said, how many of you noted the beauty in the leaves changing as you were driving up here? Of that 150 people, 12 of them raised their hand. We just, our world buzzes by and we don't notice it. But we can start to pay attention to the beauty in the world around us. Find novelty in loved ones. My kids, when I showed them this, they said, well, you should have practiced this years ago. Greet your loved ones as if you haven't seen them for 30 days. We tend to take our loved ones for granted. And the big one is try not to improve anyone in the first 5 minutes of meeting them. And this goes for not only your kids and your spouse, but fellow workers. Now maybe you can do it after 10 minutes, but at least resist that temptation for 5. And then be genuinely interested and say one good thing. You know, if you walked into work today and you said hello to Tierney and I'm texting on my phone, does she really think that I'm that interested? Look them in the face, smile at them, and give them your attention. So find novelty in loved ones. It's really important. And then kind attention. This is how we interact with the strangers and people we don't know. I was blown away by this statistic. Apparently, in 25 milliseconds, you make these five decisions about people you've not met. So whether it be, you know, the barista at Starbucks, we subconsciously make these decisions. So it's unlikely you're going to invite the person on the right to your afternoon barbecue, but you probably invite the one on the left. So we really need to start thinking about how we judge people, and that we're predisposed to this. So instead of doing that, send them a silent "I wish you well." And I think this was this next statement was the one that really struck home for me. Look at the world the way you would like the world to look at your children or grandchildren. Would you like more people starting to practice kind attention? Or do you want your grandchildren and children to be judged in 25 milliseconds how kind and how trustworthy and how competent they are? We just need to start practicing kind attention. So, training our attention so we're less prone to mind wandering. Wake up with gratitude, find novelty in loved ones, pay attention to the beauty in nature, and then practice kind attention. And then, trying to focus on these five principles. And if you go through and you look at all the sages and all the prophets, you know, they all talked about if we live our lives and it could be five or six principles, but these are principles that if we live our lives this way, we're living good, virtuous lives. And so what we'd like to do is just lower the threshold so that these just become second nature to us. And it's not that you can't practice gratitude on Tuesday or forgiveness on Monday, but it's just like, okay, we're going to focus one day of the week. And then over time, and it takes about 6 months to a year, they just become more second nature to us. So, and Laura mentioned this earlier, the day that you focus on gratitude, you're just a happier person, automatically, because you start thinking more positive thoughts. So on Mondays, you want to practice gratitude. We don't think about the countless acts of kindness that have been directed to us throughout our lives. I mean, probably no one in this room is grateful for the persons who helped their mother when they were pregnant with you, but if they weren't there to help your mother, who knows if you'd be here today. Know that we're blessed. As I mentioned to other groups, everyone in this group in this room has their different trials and tribulations, but I would say that everyone in this room has it better than 95% of people on this globe. So we focus on what we don't have, not what we do have. And then you can kind of, as you get further in this, you can focus on, well, when bad things happen, let's focus on what went right within what went wrong. So that's Monday. Tuesday's compassion. Think about this, and one of the ways to lower your threshold for compassion is that an expression other than love is a call for help. So when your fellow worker comes in and they start screaming at you about some aspect, don't focus on their negative thoughts. You know, you may focus on what's really going on in their lives. We all assume that everybody's lives are going along just perfect, but we don't really know what's taking place. You know, none of us choose to suffer. We could have been the one. What would you have done differently? They talk about that what is the most significant trait of a spouse or a significant other? That's kindness. And you cannot be a kind person unless you have compassion. Or you can try to be the person that your dog thinks you are. Or as I mentioned, you try to be the person that your grandmother thought you were, because what grandmother doesn't think all their grandchildren are just perfect? Of course, they don't have to live with them all day either. So, this actually was a photo from Life is Good, the founders of Life is Good. Have you seen those? Jake, the t-shirts and all that stuff. They came to our company and gave a talk, and this is from his book. And he talks about how gratitude has been a huge thing in their company's growth. Wednesday's acceptance. You know, we think we make a lot of decisions in life, but if you look at it, you didn't make any of these six decisions, and how much does that really impact who you are and where you are today? Do we really know what's right for us in the short term? I think the one way to lower this is, will it matter 2 years from now? And if you can kind of focus on that. So if the Starbucks coffee wasn't as hot as I wanted today, or they didn't have as many fruits or vegetables that I wanted today, if it's not going to matter to now, 2 years from now, let it go. And if we can do that, you lower your threshold to accept. And just remember that we have a lot of plans in life. Everything doesn't germinate. Thursday's higher meeting, and I mentioned, you know, it's unlikely that any of us in this room are going to be Mother Teresa. We don't have to make, you know, we're not going to have grand ideas, but we can try to be Rembrandts for our little corner of the world. We're going to try to paint our world better because we were there. We're going to try to do this best we can. So make your little corner of the world a little bit better and happier than you found it. And that may be nothing more than stopping, talking to a fellow worker, smiling at them, and really being interested in them. And then Friday is forgiveness. And I said, you can do it on other days. And we put forgiveness on Friday, because this is the hardest for humans to do. Humans love revenge. And so they did actually do a study, and they did nuclear scans on humans, and they asked them to plot revenge. It lights up your pleasure center of your brain more than a shot of cocaine will. So humans love this idea of revenge. So eventually we're all going to have to forgive and forget. It's a lifelong process. And we just need to recognize we all have imperfections. And then you got Saturday and Sunday off, so it's easier to do it on Friday. So Friday is forgiveness day. Just focus on it. And then slowly these things just become much more second nature to you. So I'm going to leave you some resources. A lot of this came out of Dr. Mitzvah's book, The Mayo Clinic Guide to Stress-Free Living. And then he followed that up with the Guidebook to Happiness. There's all kinds of books out there about happiness and gratitude. Sonja Lebrowski wrote this book about 8 years ago. And then she just followed this other book up that came out about 8 months ago, The Myth of Happiness, What Should Make You Happy But Doesn't, and What Shouldn't Make You Happy But Does. And that's all about this negativity bias and our hedonic adaptation. The Gratitude Diaries, Positivity. You can go to this website and you can actually take the longer quiz, and it will give you an idea of how happy you are on a scale. This has been researched. I will tell you, to answer it honestly, you'd hate to go to your spouse or significant other and say, boy, I'm a really happy person. I just took this quiz, and they go, no, you're not. So try to answer it honestly. And then you'll actually get, they'll send you text messages every morning, a little happiness quote. It's a really nice website, and the quiz is really nice to find out. We do tend to become happier as we age. I don't know if just because we've a lot of bad things in life have happened, or we're more content. So you have to score higher as an older person than you do as a younger person. So, you know, these are simple things. I mentioned to Tierney earlier, you know, I was always a glass half full person. But I've been doing this. We put these cards out on the counter here, and so I have it in my kitchen, and I've had it for the last 4 years, just to remind me. And I can tell you that despite being a glass half full person, I'm a much happier, more content person by practicing these principles. And if you do, then maybe you'll have a day like the people in this video, and you've all heard the song, it's Pharrell Williams' song, Happy, but you may not have seen the video. And you don't have to sit. I just gave this talk to 550 of our marketing and salespeople last week, and of course it was later in the afternoon, and they were all happy to be done with it because it was the last talk of the day. But you can get up and dance if you like. Get some of your energy, and you'll be smarter for doing it. By the way, for a project to do, wellness groups, you can Google this song and you'll see companies that put their own video together with this. And we had our global, I went to give this talk to our global audit group, and you know, the global audit group is accountants and attorneys. And you think that's not a very creative group. They actually, before I gave the talk there, so we're going to show you something. So they actually had done this to a video with them in it at our world headquarters. So it's a project you can do your own. And you could use that as a way to sell the happiness, training your brain for happiness. So I can't thank you all enough for being here. Cheryl, I can't thank you enough for inviting me. Tierney, thanks for all your help in putting this together. And it was great to be with you all.